Hi, everybody, and welcome aboard to Local Matters, where living local never felt so good. You know, AI, artificial intelligence, is here. We live with it every day. But what exactly is artificial intelligence? Should we be afraid of it? Should we embrace it? Well, that is the focus of our show today. It's going to be about automation and artificial intelligence. You know why? Because if it hits local, it certainly does matter. Dance. Let me see you move. Hi, everybody, and welcome back to Local Matters, where living local never felt so good. It certainly feels good to be joined with a young man. He is a South Carolina professor, and he is an AI and automation expert. His name is Dr. Patrick Dix, and he has been featured on many shows. He's been featured most recently with Roland Martin, PBS, the Chavis Chronicles, and not to mention, he's right here with me on Local Matters. Dr. Patrick Dix, welcome aboard to Local Matters.
Thank you for having
me. It is good to have you.
Thank you.
You know what? You know, most recently, now that we're sort of, kind of, out of COVID, we've been hearing a lot of people talking about AI. It's been sort of the new buzzword, if you will, artificial intelligence. Help me to understand, and help our viewers to understand, what is artificial intelligence?
Artificial intelligence is basically predictability analysis. It is predicting the subset of data points to see the next movement. And when you hear artificial intelligence, you should also think about machine learning. Machine learning is learning how a movement happens or how an action is executed. Basically, in the business world, the faster you can do something and save money, it is incorporated into a facility, a process, etc.
Well, so so when we hear artificial intelligence and then there's automation.
Yes.
What's the difference between automation and AI, artificial intelligence? What's the difference?
Well, automation, I'll give you some examples. If you go to a grocery store, you see the self-checkout aisles. That is automation. If you go to the airport to see those kiosks to check into. If you go to McDonald's, that is automation. Anything that consists of a process that can be automated is considered automation, and most exclusively in a manufacturing facility. So when a company says we are going to automate the facility, that means with less workers as possible, and the tasks are continuous, and they would use artificial intelligence and machine learning to learn how the individual employees perform that task, to make it faster, to make it more efficient, and eventually cut them out of the process and fully automate it.
Right. So for example, we're still on automation, of course.
Yes.
People have been complaining for years. I hate to call Walmart out, but you know, you go into Walmart and you may see maybe three real live people standing there to help you at checkout. So all of that's automation. So when you're going to check yourself out, all of that's automation.
Yes, that's automation. Because there is no artificial intelligence there to learn what you are doing. It is a manual process. You are scanning your groceries, you are checking out, and you are putting them into a bag or a cart to take them out. You're automating the whole process, which removes the cashier, which is a position that they pay for. So what happens now is, with everybody not wanting to work, I'm not going to say everybody. Let me reset. With some people not wanting to work, and Walmart gathers data from their computer systems.
Okay.
If they see that, hey, we have a certain amount of people coming in at 7 o'clock in the evening, and we don't have enough cashiers, they'll say, bingo, we have it automated, because people now want everything in a microwave society. They want to come in. They want to get out faster. So if you don't have to deal with a cashier, and you know everybody is not up to par with their social skills right now, if you can come in and be on your AirPods or your headset, get your stuff, check in, and avoid talking to people, you know, we live in a very extrovert society right now.
Introvert society.
We're in a very introvert society. So if you could check your groceries out and not deal with people and do all of this in a matter of 20 minutes to get back to your house to finish preparing your meal or get on the road, that's what happens. That is automation.
And that's just And we're going to talk about this a little bit later in the show. Because when we talk about the impact of automation, we're not even talking about artificial technology just yet. But automation has already changing us in a way where you don't have to really do a lot of interaction with people. Get in, get out. Get in, get out.
Yeah.
All right, so give me an example of what is artificial intelligence, AI, because that is what is happening now. And there are many people in society who are a little bit fearful about it.
Some examples of that would be in healthcare, writing an essay. Generating a research topic. That is artificial intelligence because in programming, you know, when I did programming when I was younger, there's something called garbage in, garbage out. What people have to realize is artificial intelligence is only as good as the information it can retrieve and extract out and populate to you. So those are three key instances. If you look now about healthcare, they're going to use AI to help with cancer diagnosis. They're going to use AI to help with generating essays for students because that the schools I teach at, they're even now trying to come up with a tool that can figure out, is this actually the student's work? Because they have turned it in and they have a safe assign. But to my knowledge, there is no tool that can actually detect there if AI has written a paper already for you.
Well, what about Grammarly? I mean, I know Grammarly's been around for a while. How do you compare that, though, to AI?
Similarities. It's pretty much AI that you brought, now that you brought it up, it is AI because it helps you choose the best words. Even in Microsoft Word, you've noticed if you complete a document and you do spell and grammar check, it'll say, this is the best word to use. Rephrase this. Those are examples of AI right there we've already been using.
Yeah, wow, yes. We've already been using and really a part of AI and not realizing. What about Siri? What about Siri? When you say, hi Siri, you know, and it's talking back to you. And people do feel like a lot of times that their phone, that the phones are listening to them. The phones, it's amazing because it's even happened to me. I would have my phone maybe in close proximity somewhere, would be talking with friends about a specific subject matter to a great degree, and I swear, the next day, it will pop up on my phone.
Yes, Siri is considered artificial intelligence and machine learning. Think about it, on your iPhone or if you have a Samsung, you have to sign into the cloud. So everything that is signed into that email address, they can start to send you spam or advertisements. It is true your phone does listen to you because I have Hulu at my house and I'll be watching something or talking to someone on the phone and an ad will pop up about, let's say we were talking about restaurants or traveling. It'll bring up flights, it'll bring up it'll bring up Expedia.
Just the information about it.
It'll bring up Expedia and the phones are listening to you. So what happens is learning the pattern and it's saying, hey, this time the previous year, Patrick was looking at this. So this time every year, I'm going to send him this information. Artificial intelligence is using machine learning together to learn your actions to send you advertisements.
Wow.
Yes.
We've got to go to break in just a few moments. When we come back, I want to talk because as an educator, I am very concerned about how AI will impact education, what we should be doing in the classroom, online, and specifically HBCUs, really working with students many times from marginalized communities. We've got to go to break. When we come right back, we're going to talk more about how AI really will and has and will impact society. We'll be right back with more Local Matters. Don't go away. Hi, everybody. Welcome on back to Local Matters, where living local never felt so good. It certainly feels good to be sitting here with Dr. Patrick Dix. He's a South Carolina professor and an expert in AI, artificial intelligence, and automation. And before we went to break, we were talking about the impact of AI in society, specifically in education. Dr. Dix, again, welcome to Local Matters. I know that you've been featured on a number of shows. I saw you on PBS. And to have you here with me now here on the set of Local Matters is certainly an honor. How did you become, quote, an expert in AI automation? I know you did your dissertation in that area. Talk to me about that. Talk to me about your dissertation and what you were looking to find.
When I did the research, well, I'll start off, I've been around computers since I was 12 years old. I'm 39 now, so my parents bought my sister, I'll never forget it, was a Tandy computer with a 3.5-inch floppy. And if many of the people out there don't know, it was a floppy disk.
I remember.
Where it slides over with the magnetic strip.
Yes.
And it would get bugs in it, it would get moisture in it, and it would ruin the disk pretty much. Useless. So they bought my sister that, and my dad had an auto paint and body shop. So engineering and working with things, and even on our farm when we were little, we were putting things together. I've always just been very inquisitive about how things fit together. And as I got older, you know, when I went to South Carolina State, I said, you know what, I'm going to major in computer science, because I went to two technical schools, and I said, you know, I don't know, I know what I want to do, but I don't know what I want to do.
Exactly.
And it hit me, I said, I'm going to do computer science. And going through computer science, majoring in that and earning that degree, going to grad school and doing a doctoral dissertation, I'll never forget, it was about in 2017 when I decided to go to Robert Morris. You're supposed to know your topic a little bit, but I remember picking up a book and reading something about, something about robotics. And I discovered they, when I say they, I mean companies are going to automate the world. This was 6 years ago.
Right.
And I started researching. And once I went to school and got my advisor and my committee, we refined the topic down. We talked about the southeastern United States at first. Then we got it down. They said, you're going to have to do this in about 2 years. And I said, I have it. Let's focus on South Carolina since it's manufacturing.
Right.
So the title of that dissertation is The Automation of Manufacturing and the Potential Effects on Rural Communities in South Carolina.
Wow. Speaking of rural communities, marginalized communities, what should people, specifically HBCUs, I know there's very few who are really embracing that the STEM subject matter. What should we be doing inside, as an educator, what should we be doing inside the classroom and even online? And not just from the higher ed, even from elementary. Where should we be starting? What should we be doing?
The curriculums are going to have to be rewritten. You know, I researched, and there are 107 HBCUs in the United States, and only four even have a robotics or automation program. So that leaves 103 HBCUs. And my university, South Carolina State University, doesn't even have a program. And I know yours doesn't.
Yes, Talladega College.
Yes.
We're getting, we're getting one up and going.
So, you know, y'all are working on getting one up together, but you have to think about the other ones that do not have one. And when we talk about elementary school, we talk about middle school, we talk about high school, the curriculums, what students are learning right now is completely obsolete. The education system, I have said this to many people, needs to be revamped. We are preparing students to be obsolete in society. The skill sets that they need to learn, arithmetic, how to have social skills, how to learn finances, how to work with their hands and be analytical and technical, we are not teaching those. People are not putting an emphasis on how are you going to be productive to society. And to achieve that, the curriculums from elementary school to college must be revamped.
So you're saying they must be changed.
They have to.
You have to embrace it.
Or you're going to become obsolete. That's the term I use with everyone. I said, if you are not helping move society forward, you will become obsolete.
There's a, in doing my research, I began to and I kept running across this term, this fourth industrial revolution. Fourth industrial revolution. Now, okay, we all learned about when I was coming up. We learned about, of course, the, you know, the very first industrial revolution when you went from manual people out doing things with their hands and went into, you know, working with machines. We're now in the fourth industrial revolution. What does that mean? Give me an example.
I'll give you an example. Digital communication, web 2.0, artificial intelligence, automation. The third industrial revolution was in the 50s, 60s, and 70s with Texas Instruments when the first computers came out. The United States and some parts of the world have not made any great strides with technology since the 70s and 80s and 90s. Whether people know it or not, the internet has been around since the 70s. The government, I think it's through the ARPA or DARPA project, gave access to Americans in the late 80s, early 90s, gave everyone access to the internet, and it was dial-up.
So you I don't mean to cut you off, but I remember the dial-up.
You had to have a modem.
And you would sit and be waiting there for it to come up, and it seemed like it took it forever.
Yeah, so they started with kilobytes. Now we have certain networks that are 10 gigabytes. So that shows you in about 33 years how fast the internet has evolved. The fourth industrial revolution, as I stated previously, is composed of automation, artificial intelligence, web 3.0, digital technologies. This is the industrial revolution that moves society forward. We're kind of right now just spinning around. Society has to move forward. Even before the pandemic, what we're going through now with artificial intelligence and automation was going to happen. The pandemic just sped it up.
It sped it up even back. Because it really did. It pushed and it launched people into technology. Mm-hmm. I remember when we got that final, I'll never forget, I was at work at Talladega College, and and I remember when we realized that we were getting ready to go full scale, everything online. It was pack up, you get your purse, pack up everything, let's leave the campus, and then let's get ready to go full scale online. I didn't freak out because I had that experience of working online. But there were some professors and teachers in many places who said, I can't do it, it's too much.
Well, to be honest, if I was the president of a university or on a board of directors, you cannot have a university without online learning. It has to be 50% in person, 50% online. And if if a board of directors or a president has someone with no vision, they have to get rid of them. You have to provide services to people. Everyone cannot come sit in a classroom. People have families, you have baby boomers that have to retrain, and you have some people that are just not comfortable being around people. So the online aspect of education is here to stay, regardless of people do not want to realize that even with work from home, we're gonna have society that is gonna be permanently working from home, and we're gonna have to have people in person. This is the way, this is the path that society is going to forward.
Yeah, this is
forward.
Where we're headed.
Yes.
Yeah, we gotta go to break. When we come back, I wanna talk about a little bit about the fear, again, that's really out here. There are people who are slow to embrace AI, they are afraid of it. A lot of this is because when we think about AI, there are people who will go back to these horror science fiction movies. And I want to talk a little bit about where AI is going to take us. We'll be right back with more Local Matters. Don't go away. Hi, everybody. Welcome on back to Local Matters. We're living local. Never felt so good. It certainly feels good to be joined here with Dr. Patrick Dix. He's a South Carolina professor, also an expert in the field of AI, artificial intelligence, and automation. Before we went to break, we were talking about how AI has already impacted society and will continue to impact. We were talking about education, Dr. Dix. We were talking about the fourth industrial revolution. I want to go back just once again because the seriousness of AI. It's here. We now know that it's not going to go anywhere. It's going to continue to expand. Whenever there is something new coming aboard into society, marginalized communities are always the last to really to be able to really grab their hands on it. I'm thinking about marginalized communities in the field of course of education as an educator. What should we be doing with our young people? Where should that focus lie? Once again, because we know now that AI is here and it's going to continue to expand.
Showing them that this is not a game. This is very real. This, as I quote to people, this is life altering. The world will never go back to 2020. You know, when we talk about 2019, the only thing that can happen now, the world is gonna get faster. And even though artificial intelligence in some aspect may be new, it's been around for 20 or 30 plus years, refining the algorithms and how it computes information, it is going to get more effective, it's going to get more sophisticated. So what you have to do is show teenagers, adults, if you don't have a skill set, this is what's gonna happen. You won't be able to be employable in the future. And we have to be very serious with young adults and kids.
But you do have to have those people who are going to compute those algorithms, if you will. So is that's one skill set there, okay? What do you foresee in terms of, and when I think about how AI will impact society, as an educator, with an emphasis in the arts, when I think about poetry, music, these things and these subject matters that make us more humane, how will AI impact those types of subject matter?
A couple of weeks ago, Drake and a couple of musicians for real were talking about AI-generated songs. AI is already generating pictures. I think you go actually to the OpenAI site. I can't remember the exact name. but it's already generating pictures. They're using AI to pretty much make old pictures better, refurbish them.
Right.
And it's already there, so we won't have to have an oil painter or somebody repaint it or spend the exorbitant amount of money to actually have someone do that. Mm-hmm. That is how AI is going to impact the arts. It can create songs, it can generate paintings, it can write music.
When you say, let's go back, because yes. I get it, because I remember, and even now, because, you know, I'm still thinking old school, well, I've got this old picture and I really need to send it somewhere. Not really, not anymore.
No, you can upload it, you can have AI do it again. The only backside to that is, whatever AI does, it keeps a copy of it. Mm-hmm. Every search you do in Google is tied to your IP address. You know, they call that forensic computing, or when the investigators come, they can see every search you've done. There are several numerous downsides to it, but are you willing to give up your Fourth Amendment right, your unlawful searches and seizures, because now it is seizing that picture to make a replica of it. Now it has it into a database.
Wow.
You have to be very, very careful about that, using that, because it has an origin to copy. So what is it doing? It's not deleting that copy. It's going to save it someplace.
It's going to save it?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yes.
Talk to me about music. You're right. I remember, this is about 2 months ago, I was driving to Atlanta, and I had it on an Atlanta station, and I heard that Pharrell was making his way up to Washington, to D.C., to talk about AI and protecting the rights of of humans, what they create.
Mm-hmm.
And now AI could take that easily and create it again. Give me an example.
Spotify, a couple of weeks ago, removed some AI-generated songs off of the charts. So basically, AI can copy Pharrell's, Drake, Adele, any singer's voice, and write a whole song. But someone should be able to hear the distortion. It sounds robotic. That is another part to it. Until they perfect it, you're going to be able to tell if it was the actual human that generated the song, or was it AI that generated it. And, you know, there's going to have to be tools for that. But, you know, many people, the first thing they hear, they're like, oh, that's a new Drake or Pharrell song. And Drake or Pharrell, or, you know, their media people will post, we didn't release a song. Well, here it is on the charts right here.
Wow.
Yeah.
What do we do then? Before we close, we're running out of time. I know, again, you've been featured on various different types of talk shows throughout the country. What are you encouraging and really urging people to do as it relates to AI? And should we be afraid of it, really?
You should not be afraid of it. You should embrace it. It is going to make certain tasks easier, and it's going to make other tasks obsolete. But people are very unfamiliar with it. That's why they're afraid of it. You know, anything new, as you was just stating previously, people are nervous about it. So there are three things I list to people, to list with people. You should retrain. When I say retrain, you have to earn a new skill set. The world is going to be built off of analytical, and it's going to be based off of technical skill sets. You can also earn a new skill set in a new career field. When we talk about career fields, we're talking about bachelor of science degrees in engineering. We're talking about computer science. We're talking about mathematics. We're talking about nursing, healthcare, even blue collar skills. Many of those tasks cannot be obsolete. Not obsolete, be automated.
It's going to be automated, yeah.
Yeah, we're talking about plumbing, electricians, HVAC, constructions, landscaping. Second, become the subject matter expert at your job. See if your job can be automated. If your job can be automated, they have to have people that still know how the technology works to build off of and to troubleshoot it. Lastly, invest. There's an article where Jay-Z invested with these two ex-Tesla engineers on a robotic food truck that they pull around and it makes pizzas. Right now, the technology is unfamiliar to people, so you can get on the cutting edge, and if you live in a food desert or a town to where there are not many restaurants, I don't know the exact amount of money it will cost, but you can invest and say, hey, we can have an automatic pizza maker to where you can get pizzas. We can pull up to a football game. We can come to a baseball game. We don't need people. We need three people that actually know how to troubleshoot it and make food for everyone.
Right, and I was thinking about places like McDonald's, Burger King.
Yes.
Do they really need people back there flipping burgers doing that? That's something the machines could do.
They already have it already. They already have robots in Chinese restaurants that flip burgers. Oh, speaking of that, Sam's already has the automatic burger maker. There's an article on that.
It sure is. I saw that article.
Yeah, they're investing in it.
Right. Thank you for this wealth of information and knowledge. I want to thank you for watching Local Matters. This information is something that we need, because artificial intelligence is here.
Yep.
It's going to continue to expand and grow. And as my pastor used to always say, the time to be ready is not the time to be getting ready. Mm-hmm. You know, we've got to start getting ready now. You know why? Because if it's going to impact local, mm-hmm. it's going to matter, and it certainly does matter. Bye. Because baby, love never felt so good.